Okay, we're going to look at chapter 8, 8.1, which is your introduction to molecular compounds. So just like Tinker Toys can show you a model of some contraption, molecular models can help to explain how atoms are bonded. So molecules and molecular compounds, how are those melting points and boiling points for molecular compounds different from those of ionic compounds? If you study this chart, notice that NaCl is your ionic compound, and H2O is your molecular compound. Notice the melting point for the ionic compound, NaCl, is quite high. That attraction between sodium ions and chloride ions is quite strong, and it takes a lot of energy to break it. Its boiling point is even higher. Boiling point is when a liquid changes to a gas. Notice for water, it's at 100 degrees Celsius, easy to obtain in our homes and in our lab. Some properties of molecular compounds. They tend to have relatively low melting and boiling points and lower than your ionic compounds. Notice all that salt in that picture, isn't it great? So we have this array of ions when you have an ionic compound. It forms a crystal lattice, and we have a formula unit, and it's NaCl. In a molecular compound, which we're focusing on water right here, we have a molecule. So you can only have a molecule when you have covalent bonds, and our formula is H2O. Noble gases are not molecules, but just to let you know that they're monatomic, and they exist as a single atom, so that we can compare them to some other things. I'll just leave it there. Covalent bond. A covalent bond is when atoms are held together by sharing of one or more pairs of electrons. We'll be looking at this in a lot of detail. My favorite, the water molecule, hydrogen and oxygen, share one pair between them. And this is a space-filling molecule and molecular model, and this is a ball and stick. Some more molecules. We have carbon monoxide, which is a C and an O. We have sulfur dioxide, which is SO2. We have carbon dioxide, CO2, which you know. So notice we're starting to put prefixes on some of the words. We only do that with molecules. Sulfur trioxide has sulfur with three oxygens, so it would be SO3. A molecular formula. It shows how many atoms of each element a molecule contains, and it's not always a low whole number ratio. So, some examples. We have methane, CH4. The next molecule is C2H6. Notice it's not the lowest whole number ratio, but this molecule is ethane. Our next one is C3H8, which is propane. In the lower corner, we have H2O2, hydrogen peroxide. H2O is water, so two very different molecules due to the number of bonds of hydrogens and oxygens, the number of atoms. Diatomic molecules. They're molecules that consist of two atoms, and you've seen Hinkelbroth on the wall in the classroom. All of those elements exist as diatomic molecules. So when you write hydrogen, it's H2. It's bonded with itself. Pure bromine is Br2. They do not exist as monatomic atoms. They're always bonded to themselves, the molecules. Ammonia is another favorite, and ammonia is NH3. All right, yesterday we used an ion, or recently, that's called ammonium. This is just ammonia, It is covalently bonded, and we have a few different structures. We have a structural formula, a space-filling molecular formula in the center, a perspective drawing to help you get a feel for where those H's are, and a ball and stick model. I've added the lone pair of electrons at the top of the nitrogen, and you'll understand why ever so soon. So, some questions, and I already have the answers circled, unfortunately. So, compared to ionic compounds, molecular compounds tend to have relatively low melting points and low boiling points. I'm going to stop for just a second. Okay, here's another question. A molecular compound usually consists of, you can read the selections, and your proper answer should be two or more nonmetals. Our last question, a molecular formula shows, and your selection, how many atoms of each element a molecule contains. That's it for our introduction, and see you soon.